Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Milbank Tweed Forum. For those of you who are new to the law school, my first year students in here, NYU was the first school in the United States to create a course on reentry, and we're quite proud of that fact. And as you look at the holdings, particularly the 2010 U.S. Supreme Court holding in Padilla, you will see that the court has begun to question in a serious way the distinction between direct and collateral consequences of a criminal conviction. One of the things that I've noticed in the first year curriculum is that there isn't often a lot of conversation about the impact of legal decisions on families and communities. So when I was given this opportunity to produce a panel for you, I wanted to focus on the issues that affect our communities and our families as a result of the possession of a criminal record. And so we have assembled what is probably one of the foremost panels in the country. Rosanna Rosado, is sitting to my left, is one of the highest ranking women of color in media in the United States. She is a publisher and CEO of El Diario, and she has been a reentry champion, both in a personal context and with regard to the paper, and she'll talk about that in a little bit. Glenn Martin, seated to my far right, is the Vice President of Development and Public Affairs at the Fortune Society. Anybody knows anything about reentry knows that Fortune is in the forefront of this work, as is Exodus. And Julio Medina, seated to my immediate right, is the founder and CEO of Exodus Transitional Community. And our last speaker, but not least, is a graduate of this law school, Mel Weiss. Anybody in here think about loan repayment when they came to this law school? Mel was the anchor and the founder of the Loan Repayment Assistance Program. He was also the founder of Milberg White. If somebody wants to clap, you should feel free. He was the founding contributor to that program and kind of the architect. And he's also had his own intersection with the criminal justice system and has some, I think, unique observations. I think we come with some assumptions about who is in the criminal justice system and what their observations might be. So I think he gives a unique perspective. I want to say that in addition to being a part of a number of conversations all around the country with these people, that they're all my friends. And so it is with great delight that I bring them to you to speak today. So we'll start with Glenn.
Sure. 7 minutes, right?
Give or take.
Okay. So I'll just give you sort of my elevator speech about the agency, what it is that we do, and talk a little bit about barriers facing people with records, especially around family issues and community. The Fortune Society was founded 44 years ago as a result of a play off Broadway called Fortune in Men's Eyes. It was written by a person who had done time in prison, who was trying to express his experience in being in prison and then transitioning back into society. From there, David Rothenberg, who was the theater agent at the time, who ultimately became the founder of Fortune, got a bunch of people coming to his office in the theater district in Manhattan, essentially saying, I hear you have this play about people with criminal records. I have a record. I need your help. He hired two of them as volunteers, and that was the beginning of the Fortune Society. And if you fast forward 4 decades to where we are now, we have 212 people on staff. Half of them are formerly incarcerated, so sticking with the mission and the idea that having formerly incarcerated people inform the work is extremely important. A third of our board is formerly incarcerated by way of our bylaws. We have developed all of our services around the needs of people who are either facing prison time in our alternative to incarceration program or coming home from prison. See about 3,000 people per year at our Long Island City location. We also have locations in Harlem on 140th and Riverside where we provide housing for people coming home from prison. And then we have a presence in all of the courts around our alternative to incarceration work. Some of the services include counseling, family services, health care. We're a licensed drug and alcohol treatment provider, licensed mental health services provider. I talked about housing. We do transitional housing for people coming home from prison where we target the most difficult cases, people who've done 20, 30, 40 years in prison, very deliberate of us to target the most difficult cases. And then now we do permanent housing. So at first, the community was against us doing housing in Harlem. 6 years later, when we were trying to figure out what to do with the empty lot behind the existing building, the community said, not only are you guys doing a good job and you should build more housing for people with criminal records, but we want to live there too. And it's been an interesting experiment in building community and family in this particular building because it ended up being supportive housing and affordable housing. The supportive housing is for our folks, and a lot of the applications there were young men of color, black, Latino, young men coming out of the criminal justice system. And then the affordable side, surprisingly or maybe not, was a lot of young women with children with no father figure in the home. So in some strange ways, we're sort of undoing what the criminal justice system has done to very specific communities here in New York City. So, and we also do policy advocacy work, so that makes us a bit of an anomaly from other large direct service providers in that we spend a lot of time addressing the systemic issues that affect people who are coming home from prison, and of course that work is extremely informed by what's happening on the service side of the agency. We have a family services unit. I know today we're going to be talking about family and community. It's one of our most important units because you could pour tons of resources into an agency like Fortune or into the criminal justice system, but if you're not tapping into the family as a resource, then you are really overlooking a tremendous resource and overlooking the fact that we probably never will have enough resources to respond to the problems of the criminal justice system. And so our work in our family services unit is to reunite families, to help non-custodial parents deal with huge child support arrears that accumulate while they're in prison, to deal with parental issues. And the idea is to, because our folks do not have to be led kicking and screaming to want to do what they're supposed to do for their children. Surprisingly, or maybe not, they are very interested in reuniting with their family, with their children, and we just sort of help make a way for that to happen and create a space for that to happen. And I hope at some point during the conversation we could talk more about how communities are impacted, because I really would love to get into collateral consequences and how that plays out in terms of having systemic impact on seven very specific communities here in New York City. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Julio Medina. I run a program called Exodus Transitional Community. But I want to open up with something that I always felt was critical, at least in, as we're doing this work and we're talking about families. And we were born to be in community. I just do not believe we were born not to be in fellowship with one another. And I say that because prison removes that possibility of being in fellowship with one another. And I think that's critical, because during my 12 years of incarceration, it wasn't the violence, the stabbings, the prison guards. It was being in isolation. It was without having the possibility to be in community. And I think that's critical when you talk about consequences and you talk about doing this work, just understanding that basic premise. Anyway, I run a program, it's called Exodus Transitional Community. It's based on the book of Exodus, so basically bondage, wilderness, and promised land. And for us, it's, you know, the bondage is a physical bondage. So for us, for me, it was the 12 years of incarceration and you know, kind of waiting and getting out and saying, it's going to be great when I get there. Never knowing that that becomes a huge wilderness process, which begins to attribute to the 60% over 3-year recidivism rate on why people going back. You know, during my time while in prison, I never heard anyone say, you know, I can't wait to come back to prison. We had to figure out something's wrong here. You know, and we really looked at that and said, what are some of the things we can do to change this and reduce recidivism? Exodus does that. So you heard Glenn's numbers. Mine's are small. So we service about 350 people a year. But we're very specific in what we do. We do 6 life areas. In these 6 life areas, we talk about family, community involvement. Community involvement, just basically talking about the community remembers me one way, and 95% of us are going back to those same communities where crimes were committed. So they view me one way. I was the robber, I was the thief, I was whatever that person was. We want to go back and say, now this is the new person, and we want to reconnect them to the family in a different way, and we want them to be a father in a different way, and we want them to be a parent in a different way. So we look at those areas and begin to talk to people around community involvement, around those family issues, and what are some of the first steps? Because someone has spent 10, 15, 20 years in prison, I think, you know, it's going to take a lot of work to understand what fatherhood really is, to understand what that gap has been while your son or daughter grew up without you. We look at education, of course, which is critical. And most importantly, you know, about 75% of people go to prison. They have a substance abuse related issue. So it could be crime, it could be getting high, whatever that is. We want to make sure those things are addressed. So Exodus does that. We've been in existence now. We're going into our 13th year in March. I would love to stand here and take a bow to say I founded it, but it was founded, you know, by so many other men on the inside after the Attica riots. Probably half of y'all wasn't even born, right? Y'all heard about it, though, right?
What's
okay.
Attica?
Okay. after the Attica riots, you know, the state decided to say, yo, we got to do some programs, and different pastors came in and talked about different groups, and Exodus was one of those models. And it was passed down, you know, from generation, and I was fortunate enough to run into it through some mentors, and I was one of the lucky ones who actually got out to incorporate this program. We're located in East Harlem, and I'm going to be looking for one or two volunteers before I leave. So thank you. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you for having me here today. And I'm really here as a, not as a media exec, but really as a relative who was involved in what I believe to be a successful reentry. But in the process, I learned so much that I want to share with you and kind of with the broader community. So I'm a journalist by training, and so before my brother, he's my cousin and he's my brother, because if you're Puerto Rican and your cousins, you're brothers, you know, primo hermanos. And so being a journalist by training, I did all the research before he was released. He did 16 years in Florida, and I said, okay, you know, I want you to come home. I want you to come back to New York, and I want you to live with us. And I went to Glenn and to Joanne Page, who's the CEO at Fortune. They got all these men together in a room. It was like a focus group, and they told me all about what to expect. And I rejected about half of what they said because, you know, they don't know me. I just will things to happen. And so I read the literature. You know, I read Jeremy Travis's book and all, you know, I mean, I'm just really good at research is what I do. So I read everything, and I was super, super prepared for this to help Andy in his reentry and to bring him home. And so I decorated a room, you know, I bought him a cell phone, I packed a suitcase with clothes and, you know, everything. And I went there on October 9th of 2007. I picked him up when he was released. And that was 4 years ago last Sunday. And then it took me about 6 months to get him out of Florida to bring him to New York, because there's no interstate compact, which is how people are transferred from one state to the other. Between Florida and New York, it doesn't exist. But I was lucky enough to have served on Spitzer's transition team, and so I served on the criminal justice panel, because I learned politics along the way in my career, and so I was able to tap into all the folks who I needed to. I basically had the New York Parole Board asking for this person to be transferred to New York to serve out his parole, right? That's unheard of. And still, Florida didn't want to let him go. But so finally, the day came in April of 2008, about 6 months after his release, when he came home. And I had prepared my husband, my children, my extended family. Everybody was super, super, super supportive for like a month. And then, you know, we kind of grappled with what families go through in reentry. The fact that none of us in the family, you know, really knew or understood, despite all the research, we just could not have a handle on what it's like to be in prison. And Julio talks about the 12 years, you know, what it looks like on the outside. So everyone, you know, I want to touch on sometimes we're dealing with unprepared families. And as an attorney, when you're dealing with these families, you're dealing with families that are really unprepared. And by unprepared, I mean just there's no help for them. You know, there's no assistance for them. There's assistance for the person who's coming out of prison, but there's no one to walk them through what to expect. So what goes on behind, you know, behind the prison walls, what that deconstruction process looks like, we're really clueless about. So we're like, well, you're free, you should be happy. You know, and so if he's walking alone in the backyard and he looks down and you're like, why should he be down? There's nothing to be down about. Are you kidding? You're free. You know, life is wonderful. And there's no idea what the individual is going through. And the other thing is, you know, well-meaning family members who kind of work against you, because, you know, when you have someone come back from prison in the family, even though people are well-meaning, they become parole officers. They're like, isn't it 9 o'clock? He's supposed to be home, you know? And so we went through all of these kind of trials and tribulations, and I'm not gonna spend a lot of time. I have great stories, but you're gonna have to read the book. And but I wanted to make the following point. So there is no help for the families, and that's why I got involved with Exodus, to kind of work with not just the participants, but also the families the mothers, the wives, the people who have been waiting, and it's much easier, even though it sounds difficult, but it's much easier to do time as a wife with someone who's in there, you know, for 10 years. But when they come out, it's a whole different dynamic, and there is very little help in the structures today, even with the Fortunes and the Osbornes and the Exoduses. There's very little help for the extended family, for that kind of integration, for that, let me tell you what's going on in his head so that you can help him, you know, walk through this. And so it was through kind of the bumping, and I think if you speak to Andy, and he's here today with me, so you can see what a success story he is, he will probably be oblivious to all the stuff that we, you know, that we went through. Although now he sees back and he's like, wow, and he looks back now on who he was 4 years ago, he's like, wow, that must have been rough on you guys. But in the 4 years, I have to say that he got his GED. 2 years ago, he got his own apartment. He has his full-time job for 2 years at Fortune. And so he's, you know, we never worried about recidivism for him. For him, he is the new definition of what reentry success is. And so you can applaud him. Thank you. And so finally, I think that the key is the support system, whether that's family, traditional family, or extended family, or the family that you kind of put together when you come out. But what I want you to understand, and this is kind of what Julio talked about, prison is about deconstruction. And that can take 10 years, that can take 16 years. Reentry is about construction, and that can take a long time. And so few of us understand what it's like to try to attempt a reconstruction of oneself, doing relationships, not dealing with who came to see me, who didn't come to see me, who sent me money, who's just reconnecting, and every relationship is so precious and valuable. And so that's what I'm finding a lot of meaning in working, and I hope that covered what you needed. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Tony, for this program. Just a little background. I practiced law for almost 50 years, graduated from this law school, started a law firm in 1965 after spending some time with a Wall Street law firm and two stints in the Army, and built a firm that at one point we had about 250 lawyers and offices in six cities. Then we went through 6 years of government investigation into what ultimately I pled guilty to, which was giving kickbacks to plaintiffs in class actions in order to induce them to act as plaintiffs in class actions, which was the crime. In any event, I wound up taking a 30-month plea, and I spent about a year in Morgantown, West Virginia, which was supposed to be a camp, but it was really a higher security than a camp because it had a special housing unit, which is solitary confinement on the premises, which a camp doesn't have, and it had about 1,100 prisoners. I would say 80% approximately were people who were in there because of affiliation with the drug industry in one way or another. There were number of doctors, some lawyers, business people, white collar type, criminals. And the population, there were about 55 Muslim prisoners, about 28 Jewish prisoners, probably about 65% were black, and I guess the rest were a variety of Hispanic or, other types. So I got into an environment that was totally new to me. And there aren't very many people who come into that environment with 50 years of legal experience. I was on the board of trustees of this law school and got some of the top awards that it gave, as I did from other institutions. Anyway, I have a lot to say about this. 7 minutes isn't a lot of time. But inside, you're isolated. And I just want to read a poem that I, something I wrote that I read to my co-inmates as I was leaving. I called it an ode to the loneliness of prison. I am in prison, and I am all alone in prison. Surrounded by many, but none do I feel are there for me. None for me. I am all alone. The past is easily remembered. It was all about me, all about me. But now here in prison, it is lonely as can be, lonely as can be. When I look into tomorrow, there is nothing that I can see that is good for me, that is good for me. Dear God, I never thought I would say it, but boy, do I need thee, do I ever need thee. And I showed it to somebody the other day, and he said, you know something? And I'm going to use your words. That's part of the deconstruction. And it leads you to a point where you are looking to a higher power, you know, for help. Mm-hmm. And then the question is it there for you? Mm. And unfortunately, it isn't in too many cases. Here is an exception, but think about what she was saying about all the effort that she put in with her background and knowledge to reconstruct one human being, okay? I'll never forget in prison, they told you you're gonna go to a halfway house. And they gave you a brochure from the halfway house, and I thought I was going to Nirvana. It had an outdoor patio, it had a gym, rooms for everybody, a wonderful kitchen. Well, I got there. It was a Salvation Army decomposed building. The chairs in the back were falling apart. The gym, the basket was hanging. The basketballs didn't bounce. It was the biggest disappointment. Now, you know, for me, it wasn't as significant because I was able to arrange to have a job, so I was able to get a weekend pass pretty readily. But these other kids didn't have family, didn't have money, and they were supposed to be there to help them transition into society and to be able to find jobs. So they had to go job searching on a daily basis until they got something, and most of the time it was working in a car wash because there were no jobs. Right, and I'll never forget. I was standing at a desk when one of the guys came down. He had just arrived the day before, or 2 days before, and he said, "I'm supposed to go on a job search, and I need a bus pass." And the woman behind the counter said, "Well, where is your authority for a bus pass? What do you mean? They told me to go job searching, this is my itinerary. Well, you don't have authority, so I can't give you a bus pass, you have to walk." And I'm standing there and it's just breaking my heart. Now, I have a lot of other things to tell you about this.
Let me start with a question for all of you, and that is that we have a room full of lawyers and folks who, as I look around the room, have made, whether it's going to be through the pro bono unit in a law firm or through their primary practice as public interest lawyers, the desire to help people in this transition back in many respects. The isolation stood out in all of your comments, everyone on this panel. What is the biggest challenge to families and to individuals in returning home that a lawyer can help with? Glenn, I'm going to start with you.
Sure. As someone who worked at the Legal Action Center for years and vetted thousands of phone calls from people coming home from prison, of course, the isolation is huge, but something that further isolates people who have criminal convictions is the collateral sanctions that are imposed as a result of having a criminal record, or the invisible punishment, if you will, which further ostracizes people and relegates them to the fringes of society. And no better way to put a person in a position where they're okay with committing the next crime than to make them feel like they're not part of the larger society. And so the work I've done with lawyers, whether public interest attorneys or pro bono firms and so on, has been around removing these collateral sanctions or helping people overcome these collateral sanctions, as well as the legislative work to undo a lot of these sanctions. Because all of these laws that we've created over the last four decades, if you will, are mostly reactionary. That's the one thing about criminal justice policy, is that it's based on fear and very reactionary and not grounded in any sort of empirical evidence, because the truth of the matter is that it does not lend itself to public safety in the long run. It feels good. I mean, if somebody commits a crime at a nursing home and they had a record, it's easy for a politician to stand there and say, we're going to introduce this bill so that people with criminal records will never work in nursing homes for 10 years. And this is a true story. This happened just a few years ago. And then when you look at the nuance of the legislation, you realize it includes people who never have any direct patient contact. You realize that in practice, it means that people who already have records, who've been working in nursing homes for 10, 15, 20 years, suddenly see this as a message from the government that you should terminate those folks. And so now people who were stably employed are unemployed, and 83% of people who are violated on parole and probation are unemployed at that time, right? So there's a strong correlation between employment and people essentially staying out of trouble. So two things, right? Handling the individual collateral consequences around education, employment, housing, voting, and so on. And then thinking of it, sort of pulling the lens back 10,000 feet and thinking about, you know, I said this a couple of times earlier, although we have 700,000 people coming home nationally, about 25,000 coming home on the state level here in New York, about 95,000 admissions on Rikers Island each year, a lot of those people coming back, they're not coming back to all over New York. They're coming back to seven very specific communities. And so think about how those communities are disproportionately impacted by so many young men of color, mostly, who are coming home with these collateral sanctions. And think of what voting must be like in the communities that need to be able to choose their elected official more than anyone else so that they can pull resources in to deal with the large amounts of people coming home from prison. Those are the same communities that have, you know, thousands upon thousands of young men of color who either are unable to vote because New York state law doesn't allow them to vote until a certain point, or because of the chilling effect of the law, even when they have the right to vote, they're under the assumption that they'll never have the right to vote again because they hear on television that in Florida you'll never vote again, and the assumption is that things are the same here in New York. So I think if I was a young, new attorney and I'm looking at these issues, I'd be thinking of it on the macro level and on the micro level.
Wait a second. I just changed my residence to Florida. Oh my God.
He needs a lawyer.
I think, no, you can't vote, yeah.
Oh, all you gotta do is get a governor's pardon. Don't worry about it.
I think some of the things, I'm just thinking of one person in particular who came to our program who was told to come by NDS, which was Neighborhood Defender Service, which is a legal aid kind of in Harlem, that was taking on some of the cases, and he had some child arrears that he owed, and he came to Exodus, and he's been there for 10 years. But I think the point of that is how can you be informed about what is taking place in our communities? I mean, if there was something in particular that you could do, is have the information at your fingertips to be able to tell someone, these are some of the things, and see, these are some of the programs out there. Because there's not one specific magic wand that we're going to be able to wave to be able to say, okay, this person's going to be okay now. He saw this. He's in this program. You know, there's a layers of support mechanisms that need to be put in place. But I think one of those mechanisms is coming into this, you know, from this non-judgmental place. You know, working with attorneys and working with DAs and kind of being on the other side of the fence, you know, to be considered this lowest form of humanity when you go through this criminal justice system, and then being dehumanized throughout that process, you know. And then you're saying, you know, you're told you're now released and now, you know, you're going to be okay and, you know, we want you to go out there and get a job. And then those kind of... invisible barriers that come into place, meaning that felony, when you go to the job and it, and you're told, you know, you have the job, and this goes on, you know, it's numerous times. I've been at Exodus 13 years now, and if it doesn't happen, you know, five times a month, you know, easily, where someone gets the job and then comes back and, you know, 2 weeks later, well, you know what, we really didn't want you and we got somebody else, et cetera, whatever excuse it is. So now this person is now brought back into a court. He's unemployed. He's trying to take care of his family. He's trying to do all these other things. But yet there's no sense of income. There's no, you know, there's just no resources available. You can begin to take a snapshot of why recidivism rates are so high. And I think as attorneys, one of the things is have the information, be armed with information, because there's you know, a lot of policy and a lot of work that you can do on these other levels. But if they don't match on the ground, if these things are not meeting on the ground, it's not going to work. So, you know, just keep an eye out for those things. Keep an eye out for what's happening in the community. Glenn mentioned those seven neighborhoods. Of course, those seven neighborhoods are the most impoverished neighborhoods. Those seven neighborhoods, dropout rates are 50%. Those seven neighborhoods, you know what color the people are in those neighborhoods. So it's kind of, you know, really looking at this and calling it what it is and saying, you know, we come out, we're coming into this work without judgment, and we're coming in this work to help. And I think from that standpoint, you know, we can create miracles together.
Well, I think that from the family point of view, one of the things I became involved in 2006 or 7, I think it was, I know Glenn was involved in the telephone justice campaign, which is another way that we look at, you know, the issues that impact the family. So New York, this was in New York State, but this happened all over the country. Correctional systems were entering into very lucrative contracts with phone providers so that they used one provider. It was the only provider you could use. So if you were in prison and you were calling home collect, it could cost the family anywhere from $200 to $400 a month, you know, extra, you know, in addition to whatever the $150 they need if they want to go up to visit, you know, once every couple of months. And so I became involved, or the paper became involved in editorializing. And it was the first thing that Elliot Spitzer did when he became governor was terminate, you know, the terms of that contract, and that the state should not make money on the families. It was like a tax for the families of prisoners. And there are many issues like that that, you know, attorneys can look at on the policy side. It takes research, it takes activism. I would say get close to the organizations that are doing this work, and there are many issues. I think one of the outstanding ones that both Julio and Glenn mentioned is that whole child support arrears, so that if you're in prison for 16 years and you come out before you can even attempt kind of a unification with your kids or some kind of relationship with your baby mama, you have child, not just arrears, but penalties, you know, so you have interest on those arrears. Even though you were incarcerated by the same state to whom you owe the money, and the same state would not pay you a salary for the work that you did. And so there are a lot of ways to attack these issues legally through, and you know, legislatively and through lawsuits and things. And I think there's so many people better prepared in the city, you know, to kind of brief you on those. I'm sure Professor Thompson can help you with that.
Sir?
I think that, you know, the legal community is the most articulate probably that we have as a group, and they're used to being advocates for, you know, for their clients. And instead of thinking about lawsuits, I think that the legal community should form an organization or a number of organizations to promote reforms and to get people to understand that their conduct is inappropriate and doesn't do society any good. I mean, just as an example, take the media. Remember there was a helicopter crash a couple of weeks ago? And this poor guy, you know, he was the pilot, and he was showing his friends from out of the country around, and they crashed, and it was a terrible tragedy. And 2 days later, New York Post, helicopter pilot and ex-con. Now, he served in 1981. He's lived an exemplary life for 30 years. what the hell is that all about? What does that fact have to do with what happened that day? And think about the impact on him. You know, there's nothing I can do that doesn't resurrect all of that dirt about me. You know, when Madoff's trustee sued me in a clawback case, which I think is an improper lawsuit on a number of levels, he started that action against me before he started it against anybody else because he knew it would make headlines. And it did. And there I was in the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, along with the Wilpons and, you know, all these other guys who were very close to Madoff. I'm sorry, I thought I shut that off.
My students do that, so that's
because I had a criminal record. The media feeds into this stuff. And I think the legal community should start standing up against it. I can't tell you, I mean, just to give you an example of how bad it is, I was huge in the Democratic Party in terms of supporting it and raising money for it and contributing to it and doing other things. And I was at a festival in my hometown in Oyster Bay, the Oyster Festival, last year. And one of the biggest politicians in our country, who I was like this with, who I raised tons of money for, I'm walking, and it's crowded, and I have my family with me, and I'm walking, and he's walking towards me. I didn't know he was going to be there. And I saw him. I had just gotten back out of, you know, confinement and halfway house and stuff. And I was excited, and I walked over with my hand outstretched to shake his hand. And he was like this, and he said, "There's reporters around me." Mm. "There's reporters around me." Mm. What a disgusting human being. Mm. So I just turned around and I walked around him. And I'm going to get even with him one day.
We're going to move right on. I'm in trouble now.
Shut the cameras off.
Yeah, cameras and all we want to do. You guys have any questions? Any questions for you guys in the back?
Not with this. Not with this.
I think you make a good point. We always say in our world that it, you know, if it bleeds, it leads. So that's what makes the news when things go wrong, unfortunately, even though for every one person that commits another crime, there's thousands of other people who come out and want to do the right thing and people who do the right thing. At Fortune, you know, we have obviously a limited budget outside of our service budget, but we've tried to do things like we put up a billboard in Midtown Manhattan last year in Times Square during the holiday times that said, "You think prison was tough? Try finding a job once you get out." And the idea is to create some transparency around the criminal justice system, because even though we have 2.3 million people in prison and 7 million people under criminal justice supervision, in many ways you can go through your life and never deal with this at all, right? And never see it, because all the prisons are located in rural communities upstate and so on. So I think part of it is, you know, folks like Mel, who obviously can get a ton of attention, being courageous enough to still talk about this. You have people like Martha Stewart, who did time and who have decided that's it. She's done. She's walked away from it. And eventually, you know, for someone like her, it may just go away where people are not talking about it. But for someone like Mel and other people who can garner media attention to stand up here and say it's the right thing to do. I mean, I did 6 years in prison before I started doing this work. It's important to me because of the people I left in prison, the really smart, intelligent, bright people that I left doing three, four, five, ten times the amount of time I did for crimes that were much less serious. That's what motivates me. But I'm not going to get the sort of media attention that other folks will get who have done time in prison. So I think that that's a critical component of opening up this issue to the general public.
Let me say one other
thing. Since I'm media, right?
Media's feeling some pressure here.
Well, I don't want to speak for all media, and definitely not for the New York Post. But I think that one thing that we can do collectively, I'm not going to defend, you know, what gets on the front page, but that we do need to change the vocabulary, and that we need to insist, as those of us who are doing work in the area, as lawyers, as other professionals, we have to really insist on using terms like, you know, alleged, you know, accused. You know, I've been working with the Exodus team now for almost a year, and the other day we did an editorial support, you know, about the second chance stuff in the Senate, and my editorial writer wrote, you know, ex-offender, and I'm like, oh, we don't use that term. And she's like, what do we use? And I'm like, I don't know, call Julio and ask him what term we use. But you're gonna stop referring to people as, you know, ex-cons or offenders. I mean, there's some government language, but we need to change the way we describe people, change the way, you know, we use language. And I think that as we do that and we try to impact the way that media uses language, that we can change the perception. And that, you know, I think Tony said most of us, or Glenn said most of us don't see this, you know, because everything is far away. But in the work that I, you know, in being involved in this for a year, I have been in boardrooms and breakfast rooms and classrooms all throughout the city. And the moment I start to tell the story, everyone has a story about reentry. Everyone has been touched by it. Everyone has, you know, an uncle, a cousin, a neighbor, you know. It's just that we don't talk about it. And I think one of the things we can do collectively is also to talk about it.
Let me say two things. One is that I see some of my students and some of Professor Bell's students in the class, and you will all be writing op-eds. And one of the things that you can do is that the public is actually surprised. My clinic students who go out and do field work are surprised that people haven't paid their debt to society when they walk outside the doors, and don't always connect the dots with the political rhetoric that both Glenn and Julio so eloquently described, and the collateral sanctions that happen to people. So I think using the vehicle of public education as a citizen, because believe it or not, even after we give you your JD, you're still citizens. So writing op-eds and being active in thinking about the rhetoric that we use, to use my colleague's line, is very important. And I think the public is a bit surprised. So I think bringing that to the public, this notion of a scarlet letter, is very important. Other questions in the back?
Hi. I wonder how we can challenge, as you know, certain policies that seem right-minded, I guess. Like, for example, I recently discovered that there was a law that was just declared unconstitutional by a Bronx Supreme Court judge, that if you are convicted of a violent felony, you are you're completely excluded from getting your parental rights back after your time is served. And I wonder, to me that seems ridiculous, because if you've served your time, then in theory you should be reincorporated into the community, especially into your own family. But I can also understand the argument in the reverse of protecting children, and I think we see this a lot in the collateral consequences of the convictions for sex offenses. And I just wonder, how do you challenge some of those policies that the public is aware of and the public sometimes believes is right, even if it's not conducive to reentry?
So two immediate thoughts. One is that there are two states, you all have heard of an environmental impact policy. There are two states which have correctional impact policies. So we should demand that legislatures do two things. One, have a sense of what the correctional impact of new criminal justice policy will be, one. And two, the Attorney General has been quite eloquent in saying that as a nation we need to be smarter on crime. And the way the federal government has interpreted that is to begin to think about criminal justice policies that are evidence-based. So if there was some, and Glenn made reference to this, if there was some suggestion that there's data to suggest someone who has in fact done their time and been successful on parole should not have parental rights, then that would make sense because it would be an evidence-based practice. I can offer to you now that there's probably no correlation of evidence to suggest that that individual shouldn't have their parental rights restored. But I think demanding legislative policies that are based in evidence rather than in rhetoric is a step in that direction. Do you guys want to?
I just want to talk about employment, for instance. You have employers that 80% of employees do background checks, right? Anyone in this room who has a credit card, can start a background check company, first of all, but any employer can really do a background check these days, small, medium, large. And the first thing employees do when they see something on the background check is they say, whoa, this person has like this burglary conviction. I'm not going to hire them because they're going to reoffend in the workplace and I'm going to face liability. All the evidence says that's not true, right? In fact, there was research done by a researcher named Blumstein and Sean Bushway that actually shows that even a person with a serious crime, an armed robbery conviction, after 7 years has no more of a propensity to reoffend in the workplace than a person who's never committed a crime before. And so hopefully we're moving towards more evidence-based practice in terms of our criminal justice policy making. My fear, however, is that we are mired in a bunch of policies that we've already created over the last four decades that have really served to undo just about everything people have gained during the civil rights era, for instance. I don't think it's a coincidence that we went from the civil rights era proper to a huge spike in incarceration and then all the collateral sanctions that go with it that essentially served to undo everything that was gained during the civil rights era. I mean, here in New York State, for instance, around that time, we had 12,000 people in prison. We ended up with a high of 78,000 in 1992. And so I'm just suggesting that while we need to be thinking of these things to sort of stem the tide, that there's a lot of rollback that has to be done.
I think on this line, I told Tony about a friend out west who hires ex-prisoners and has had the most fabulous experience with that hiring system. And you know, organizations like yours can do spotlights on these people, have this guy on a PR campaign, and he'll do it, going around and talking about how you can get fabulous workers who are reliable and what his personal experience has been. I think we have to promote that image to show that it really works and to change people's belief that it just doesn't.
Also around that, just via violent felony offenders, VFOs are least likely to recidivate, as Glenn mentioned. It. More than likely, they're doing more time, kind of age out of crime at that point. So it's looking at that as well and being able to, and this is to the, I'm sure not everybody's, some people are going to go to the prosecution side, right? Not everybody's just going to defend people, right? So for those who are going there as well, I just think it's important to understand that. I just think it's important, I don't want to sit here and wave a banner that everyone should be out of prison. And I think there's practices that help. That can, we can release right now. I heard Glenn earlier, and I totally agree. We could bring our prison population right down, I think today, to 40,000 and still not be threatened by a VFO or anything else. Because there's some people who are languishing in prisons still under the old Rockefeller laws with 25 to life for first time sale for, 4 ounces, which isn't a lot. I mean, so when you look at it, and I think when we talk about this conversation, and I heard Tony talk about evidence-based stuff, understand that some of these statistics tell us that, VFOs are least likely to recidivate. They, more than likely it'll be the first-time drug guy who's still young, 19, does 2 years and goes back. But of course, parole policies will let this person out and will not let out the person who's least likely to come back to prison. So even you want to put people away, we can do that in a sense when you have the information in front of you. You can really do it in a way that says, this is the time that you should be doing. There's people who always talk about, we can't bring a life back. If someone has lost their life, that life can't be bought back. There's nothing they could do. The parole board goes on and on with hitting people. That's, you know, 2 years every time you appear before them. They'll go 2 years, 2 years, 2 years for that same instant offense, which now I think recently they tried to change some of these laws. My point is that if we look at the practice, if we look at, you know, kind of what are some of the things we can do, and we change the language, what I heard someone talk about, I think it'll become a more fair process where if we can just remove this get tough on crime platform, you know, that's been in existence, you know, prior to your birth to, you know, recent, that, you know, if we lock them up, we'll get the votes, and we don't, and now it's starting, the tide is starting to change around this rehabilitative platform where they're saying, yeah, you know, and it's only because we can't afford prisons no more. I like to say it ain't because, you know, people just feel we just can't afford it no more. So people are saying we are going to reduce our numbers. But I think it's important. It's really important just to look at some of the statistics that are out there. And if we do that, we will be better attorneys, better district attorneys, all those things, because we're doing it not with with judgment, but we're doing it based on the law.
And I just wanted to make a comment about the, because she brought up the well-meaning stuff, and this I think is worthy of a whole forum that I'm not prepared to or equipped to talk about. But when it comes to sex offenders, juvenile sex offenders and sex offenders in general, there's so much the public doesn't know, and there's so many ways in which the law and medicine don't agree. And I think as law students that we need to look at the big picture, and that so we only know sex offenders that we see, you know, on television. You know, we have those reality shows where they catch someone when they actually catch someone and they're going through due process before they've even committed a crime. And there's some real, I feel like there's some real dangers there in terms of civil liberties. But because it's sex offender, all bets are off and you can kind of go after people. And that's going on in, you know, kind of DAs all over the country. And so it's definitely worthy to look at because it's well-intended. But there are a lot of disturbing things that we see in the process. So, what is
it? This is sort of related to what Mr. Medina said about sort of the movement towards saving money and sort of like, all, you know, closing prisons to save money, but not necessarily because we think they're a bad idea. What I'm interested in is how this is a crisis that influences, like disproportionately influences poor communities and communities of color. And so one of the ways you can sort of try to get the message out about it is through this sort of like public safety, like sort of way of talking about it, which is sort of like code for being like, this is gonna be good for all communities, right? So therefore you should support it, kind of like interest conversions kind of thing. So I'm just wondering whether you think that there's a tension between that obviously and saying this is a huge crisis, there's like harm being perpetuated. So I'm just wondering in general, how do you deal with that tension? Or, you know, is it sort of like you just push both messages at the same time? Like, I'm just kind of interested in that.
Good question. I mean, I think you know, it is. It's that balance. I think Glenn does it much better than I do, you know. But it's that balance. It's that balance of trying to talk to our political people and letting them know, you know, we want to work and we understand that you know, prisons should be closed. Should they have been closed in the city, that's a whole nother, you know, story when so many upstate prisons remained open and disproportionately the amount of people, not to mention the color. We you know, that conversation, I think it's something that we balance, that we I don't want to say disguise around public safety, but that we, you know, we talk through with public safety in mind. But again, I think it's just critical that that message be brought out. More importantly, that those messages be brought out.
So it's a good thing I don't run for office because I flip-flop depending on who the audience is. So I try to gauge my audience. The other day I was on. The other day I had lunch with a few folks, and Grover Norquist was at lunch, and then he was ultimately on the panel afterwards. And for him, it's not a conversation about it necessarily being morally the right thing to do or that it disproportionately affects people of color. Because I've seen some people glaze over, like the upstate, rural Republican politicians. Mm-hmm. If you lead with race, you've lost them. Mm-hmm. You know, and so a person like, you know, Grover, I would start out talking all about the huge cost of incarceration, $69 billion per year on our prison system, a system that has a failure rate of 2/3 over 3 years, the only industry allowed to operate with that failure rate and continue to operate. And that resonates with him. And at the least, it gets him to the table, it gets the conversation going. And then I found that 20, 30 minutes into the conversation, he was saying some things that were factually incorrect, and he was asking for certain evidence from his more progressive counterpart counterparts to help make the case to his colleagues. And it at least inspired a deeper conversation, even if the lead into it wasn't some of the things that motivate me to do the work necessarily.
So it strikes me that collateral consequences are a good example of how law fails to control the meaning of punishment. And I wonder what you think about the viability of sentencing reform and changing lawyers' practices at sentencing and making sure that before the sentencing judge, all the material with respect to other collateral losses are put before the court, and that in a system of punishment that's based on a principle of proportionality or retribution, which the U.S. system is, it seems to me relevant that that material would go before the sentencing court. I understand the Bronx defenders are starting to do this sort of thing. I know there's a rule in Canada that if there's immigration consequences, which there are if you get a sentence of longer than 2 years, that that material has to be before the sentencing judge and that she has to turn her mind to it. She may decide to impose that sentence anyways because she finds it's an appropriate sentence, but if she doesn't consider the immigration consequences, then it's an error of law. She didn't know the meaning of her sentence. So I was wondering what you think about that.
That's a great question. I actually want to take a run at that, and I want to talk about culture and I want to talk about law. So that was a very micro question about sentencing. And one of the things I want each of you to do that does an internship this summer, whether it is in a law firm or a public sector environment, is to question why things are done. And one of the things I always like, I was a public defender for a decade in Northern California, and I always liked working with students because they would come in and say, why do you do it this way? And you'd have to actually think about it. One of the things that happens in public defender offices throughout the country, and I've trained public defenders all over this country, the culture is not to do a significant sentencing hearing. And it often happens when you have a retained lawyer, but the judge gets cynical, and the lawyers feel like there's no reason for me to put it on. I just did a plea, or I just did a full-blown trial. Go in there and question why they're not putting all the mitigation evidence and all the facts before that judge, notwithstanding the verdict by a jury or a plea in that case. And I think that's where we have to challenge the practical culture of lawyers. That's one. Second, I think that Padilla was an interesting case. I think that Padilla opened the door for how automatic immigration consequences are as a result of a plea in a criminal case. But you know what? I've got people in this room, Rachel, who is an expert in housing and ex-offenders. I've got the other Rachel over here who has worked in New Orleans in a public defender's office, or people in this room who have done the work. And guess what? Public housing consequences are equally automatic. You're excluded from public housing. Employment consequences, I've got two experts on my panel, are automatic. So I think the notion that there are other consequences that should be advised as a matter of law, there may be an opening, there may be a crease or a crack in that door in Padilla. So we need to begin to think about novel legal arguments that we can make to say, wait a minute, if the issue is automatic, we see a range of collateral consequences that clients should be advised about as they go forward. And I want each of you in this room to challenge the notion that it's been done this way for decades, so we should go in and continue to have it done. Because you guys are gonna make the change in the society about issues like this. So, please.
I think that judges have to really be taught about the consequences of what they're doing. There was one fellow I served with. It was a commercial crime. I think the total amount of money involved was $600,000-$700,000. He went to trial. He was an Israeli. And he had a tough veneer. And he lost. He could have made a deal for something like 3 years, and he refused to take the plea. He gets convicted. He makes a deal with the prosecutor for 4 years not to appeal. Judge gives him 14 and a half years. He had three kids. One was just born. I saw these kids come twice because they came from Israel. The only time they saw their father was in this visiting room in a jail. From the time one was an infant and the other was like 2.5 years and the other one was 3.5 years when he went in. The visiting rooms are terrible places to bring those kids to. I mean, they're crowded spaces. They're not outdoor places where the kids can run around. There's one little room. We're a camp with 1,000 prisoners. There's one little room to take kids to play with some toys. The impact on those kids is horrible. Does the judge understand that? Does he think about it? Does the lawyer explain it to him? We've got to make an impact on the judiciary throughout the country as to what they're doing to families and to these kids and the impact on them from these sentences. Make no mistake about it, and I'm sure anybody who served time will tell you, it's almost like when we handled the Holocaust cases and we had to make a decision whether to treat somebody who was in a death camp for one day differently from people who were there for 6 months, and we decided just being in the death camp, that's enough. Being in prison is not a place that anybody really wants to be. Well, there are some that do because they have no other life. Make no mistake about it. I mean, some of them, it's three squares and they have some camaraderie because they get into a gang culture or whatever. But for the most part, being under the thumb of the government and jailers is no fun. There's no health care that's worth a damn. The food sucks. The education system is non-existent. I mean, forget about it. You gotta educate the public as to what this all means.
Other questions? Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it.
I'm wondering what your thoughts on limiting some of the collateral consequences through strengthening of state expungement laws, which do exist in almost every state except two that I know of, but are almost completely useless.
I mean, my experience, you know, I've done some legislative work. I've actually drafted legislation and gotten it passed here in New York to increase employment protections for people with criminal records. My experience with expungement statutes is that they're really non-starters these days for most elected officials. I think it's because most of them just don't have the spine to stand in front of their constituents and say this is what they're gonna do. What I have seen have some traction here in New York is conditional sealing, the idea that you get the case sealed and then if there's some other criminal justice involvement, the case is reopened as a result. And you know, the closest we've gotten on anything expungement related here in New York State, at least in the 10 years I've been doing this work, is just almost not even worth its salt. It's just not even worth the effort, to be quite honest. And you know, with the explosion of background check companies, right? I mean, it's not even, if you look at what's going on, the phenomena is not necessarily that we're just locking up more and more people and imposing more and more collateral sanctions, but that the explosion in technology means that people who are able to sail under the radar just 10, 15, 20 years ago are no longer able to do so, which is interesting because it means that suddenly there's a group of folks who were okay with not having this discussion once they got out of prison, suddenly at the table with us saying, oh my goodness, we need to have this conversation because almost no one goes under the radar anymore. And I think that that will maybe inspire the need for this, to rekindle the conversation about, you know, getting rid of these criminal convictions after a certain amount of time. Here in New York City, the mayor just passed an executive order that says that no city agency can ask about a criminal record on the initial job application. And the idea is to give job seekers with criminal records a chance to at least sit in front of the decision maker and make the best case about why they're the most qualified candidate. And part of that executive order, just up until the night before, 11 p.m., I was on the phone, essentially said that if there was a misdemeanor that was more than 7 years old, that it would not be counted at all by any city agency. And by 12 p.m., we lost it. And then, you know, we got the executive order, but I just couldn't understand why we didn't, you know, why we lost that small, almost insignificant, but important, nonetheless, provision. So I guess the short answer is I'd love to see expungement as a person with a felony record whose life is totally different than it was 15, 20 years ago, but I'm not hopeful.
So there are two problems with felony expungement issues. One is the volume of access to information, because now you can pay $10. In my reentry course a few years ago, I was shocked when I said, you know, you can go online and get somebody's record for $10, and half the women in the thing said, yeah, we do that all the time when we date men. And I just was shocked. But the truth is, part of it is the volume of access, and part of it is the incorrect, the high percentage of incorrect records. So on that second issue, I think that the way it works is that courts, state courts, do data dumps, and they give these private agencies, they sell to these private agencies records. Those records are often incorrect. And states have avoided liability by saying, we're not selling credit information. And I think litigation that identified states under the Federal Credit Reporting Act would increase liability in states, and you would find very accurate records if you could sue the states on this. And so I think one issue is the volume of access, and Glenn speaks very eloquently to limiting or narrowing that. And the second is accuracy. And I think that you as lawyers can begin to think about novel legal theories to get at states who are doing these data dumps and have no affirmative obligation to ensure the correctness of the records. I think we have time. Jonathan, how am I doing on time? All right, so question, other question. Where? Oh, all the way in the back. Camilo.
Thank you. My name is Camilo. I'm a third-year student. I was hoping the distinguished panel could help me out with a question that may affect many of us who have worked in this field previously. And that's that by no means is it any secret that this issue has been cast as a black and brown issue, as a poor folks issue. And I'm wondering that battling that trajectory, and certainly the exceptions of Bloomberg's blackmail initiative here in New York City being a counter to that, I'm wondering how one actually builds, speaking to popular education, those referenced earlier, a consensus when, for the most part, the funders, right, building the financial resource, is not in tune to the stakeholders. Specifically speaking, with the exception maybe of our panelist, Mr. Weiss, that we depend on contributions from these foundations that otherwise wouldn't want to fund these cases. So I'm hoping that perhaps, naively so, the silver lining to this cloud that has overcast and hamstrung advocacy might have some tips from those of you up front.
Can we build consensus?
Can we state the question?
So how do you build consensus around this issue?
Chuck Colson, you know, built a big organization, but I'm not sure that it's very effective. I don't know what it really does, except pay maybe some big salaries to people. And
yeah, Camille, I think that the challenge to your question is the assumption that money, I mean, money has a role in this, and the two gentlemen who run organizations on the ground seated to my right have been excellent at raising money. But I don't know that money is the necessary component. Glenn, is
that right? So, right. That's helpful. Thank you.
Go ahead.
So I do work for an agency with a significant budget. It's an $18 million budget. I'm in charge of fundraising for the agency in addition to policy and communications. And we have been exemplary at raising government funds, federal, state, local, private foundation money, convincing foundations who don't necessarily think about this issue, but who may care about poverty, disease, healthcare, education, and so on, that this is a core issue for them and that the people who end up in the criminal justice system really are the products of our failed policies, and so they should care about this issue. But around the policy front and changing policy, most of the advocates that are working on these issues don't get a ton of resources to do the work around the advocacy side. George Soros cares about this, the Soros Foundation, Public Welfare Foundation, Annie Casey, Mott Foundation. A handful of foundations really are out the gate saying we care about criminal justice policy reform, but not many. What I've found that has brought folks to the table, like Chuck Colson, like Newt Gingrich, like other folks, is I'll tell you what happened. In 2004, during the State of the Union address, President Bush talked about the large numbers of people coming home from prison and essentially said to Congress, what are we going to do about it? And then created on his own the President's Prisoner Reentry Initiative and diverted dollars through the Office of Community and Faith-Based Initiatives, which, interestingly enough, not just opened up the door for more conservative players to come to the table, and have a discussion that was different than the traditional discussion about being tough on crime, but also brought the Christian right conservative to the table in a significant way on this issue, which opened up the door more than resources, if you will, to bring a diverse group of people to the table to start engaging in this discussion. Was it consensus right away? Have we seen consensus in 7 or 8 years? Not necessarily. But I think the inclusion of this concept of, you know, redemption, transformation, second chance, actually has brought more of the more conservative element to the table than any amount of money I've ever seen in the past poured into this particular issue.
Did that get out of his question? No.
Hi, I'm Aisha Bennett. I'm as well. And thank you. I recently attended a talk with Michelle Alexander, who I think some of you have kind of been invoking her new book, The New Jim Crow. And one of her suggestions, or at least one of her arguments were that we don't even necessarily have to accept the idea that prisoners don't have the right to vote, like, while they're incarcerated. And that just kind of reframed my thinking about, you know, where reform should actually be pushing. And she said that is a model that has actually been followed in certain countries. And so I'm curious to what extent the international community has solutions for us that we should be paying attention to.
I think I was at the symposium where she said that. And, you know, I, as a person on the ground that's been doing the work for a while, I'm very pragmatic in my approach, right? Also reminding myself day to day to not get to the point where I'm capitulating way too early on. And so her statement, that statement sort of reinforced for me that I need to continue thinking about where you draw the starting line, if you will. And giving the right to vote back to people who are on parole, for instance, here in New York State, is a tough sell. It's a very partisan issue. It's the only bill I've ever brought up to Albany and had a legislator say right to my face, "This is great, but these are your people. Good luck." Like, quite literally, that was his response to the bill. So it's a very partisan issue. Maine and Vermont never take the right to vote away from people who go to prison. But if you go to Maine and Vermont prisons, and Maine and Vermont in general, it's really hard to find a person of color to begin with, right? So a lot of it has to do with race. And the states that are more stringent are the states that have held on to slavery and Jim Crow for their dear lives. So I appreciate Michelle reminding us to sort of shoot for the stars and hopefully land on the moon. But as a person on the ground doing the work, I find that that doesn't pass the laugh test when I'm up in Albany, if you will. And I want to at least do things that are conversation starters, as difficult as it is even for me to say that out loud.
You know, in Puerto Rico, the prisoners vote first. You know, but we can't vote for president anyway, so that's kind of a bad thing. But I was there when she said that, and I was intrigued because I actually was not aware, except for Puerto Rico, that there were other states that did that. So, I mean, I get Glenn's point, and I don't think it's something that people like Glenn can undertake, but it's certainly a movement that people like you can undertake, you know, from your perch and from this kind of, you know, of collective. I think that's the right thing.
And so, I think there was another part to your question about international. And I was lucky enough to, it was weird, this is one of my weird stories. I had lunch with Richard Gere a few years ago. Yeah, this is, it, every time I start, that's the response I get. And as a Buddhist, he cares about prison issues, people in prison and so on. And it was about, that's what the conversation was about. And he talked about, you know, as a person who's traveled around the world extensively, he talked about countries in the Middle East that essentially, when he talks to them about collateral consequences, they sort of don't even get the concept, right? Not to say that their criminal justice system is something to look towards as a model, but the fact that you are punished beyond what's imposed by, you know, the court system was just some of the countries he's been in, they just couldn't even fathom that. And in some of those countries, you vote while you're sitting in prison. So again, that was sort of a reminder for me that we need to, you know, start really far out and then see where we land.
I gotta hang out with you, Glenn. So let me say two things. One, if you look at the Supreme Court's decision in Roper, Justice Kennedy selectively used international conventions to challenge the notion that we as a nation would use the death penalty against children. And I think, although Scalia scoffed at it a bit, I think that there are some places where we can import international conventions in our analysis, but we must be very careful because our legislatures tend not to import notions of justice, but export them. And so I think we have to be careful in that, okay? But this is a good question, Aisha.
By the way, it protects me from all those politicians coming to me for contributions. and just the other day, I was thinking, some of them sent my money back to me. But others said that they were going to contribute the money I gave them to charities. And then I said to myself, why didn't I take a tax deduction for a charitable contribution?
We have time for one more question.
I'll give you my card now.
No other question. Up in the very back.
I thank you all for speaking with us today. You know, I've been thinking a lot of, I think everybody in this room probably agrees that reentry is an issue that everybody needs to be focusing more on, just generally speaking. And I think that there are an increasing number of criminal justice agencies, specifically the community-based ones, so probation and parole, police, who agree, who think reentry is smart practices. And not all of them agree necessarily, but for those progressive agencies that realize they can't necessarily arrest their way out of the problem or revoke their way out of the problem, what can they contribute to the reentry experience of people returning back from prisons and jails?
That's a great question. So I train probation officers and parole agents and some DAs around reentry. I don't think Glenn knew that, so you just outed me, so thank you. But I think that coming in the beginning of the process with the knowledge that there's a problem, and I think parole agents in particular understanding with regard to those folks who have been, as Mel and I guess everybody talked about, so significant are numbers of people affected by the drug epidemic in the country, understanding that relapse is a part of recovery and that there's certain components of relapse, not only taking of drugs relapse, but the kind of stresses on relationships. Having that knowledge as they come with the client to deal with the client is important. And I think their perspective. If their goal is surveillance, they can find technical violations and reincarcerate people. If their goal is success and rehabilitation, then they can make allowances and make connections in communities to make people successful. So I think it's perspective from the leadership in those organizations that is very important. And I think we've come a long way as a country to having district attorneys and parole officers and probation officers and chief parole officers and chief probation officers that understand reentry has to be a part of the landscape. But you guys see it on the ground. What else would you add?
Just adding to what we're working with probation right now and watching them. And that's from the, it usually happens from the top down. And you know, Yashiradi is this new probation commission that is really doing a great job. It's come in and said, you know what, we want you to be really community-based. And for some time, we had a conversation with probation about having them base that exodus, which would have been wonderful where people are coming in and you're not walking through metal detectors and it becomes a very community-based kind of approach to how do we help people? How do we help our young people? So I think probation is really getting the tune. Of course, that didn't happen, but that probation is taking those steps. And I think when you look at parole as well, they are beginning to take those steps to understand that CBOs have a role in this reentry process. And I think Upper Manhattan does a fantastic job on putting all this together as well, and has all the providers, and has parole, and has it's a drug court, and everyone's working in conjunction with to make this work. We still have a long way to go, because, some people just, it's punitive and lock them up and that's it. But we're moving in that direction.
So two things. One, there are three people in this room that many of you probably don't know you should know. The gentleman seated right there is Michael Lorry. Jeannie Forrest, who you get emails from but maybe have never seen, is having the red sweater. And Jonathan Biondi has the really cool purple shirt on over here. They make this forum happen. And without them, this forum wouldn't happen. So I want to personally thank them. You guys have a lot of choices in what you do during the course of your day, even though there are no classes scheduled during this time. And I appreciate you taking the time to do this. So thank you. And please thank my panelists for sharing.